When we all went to bed,
service is a very important service for all leaders that has been chosen to work in God's army. And as I was looking at your information on the back of your program, and as Paul wrote to Timothy, he wrote to Timothy to teach him because he was a young pastor. He wanted Timothy to know all that he needs to know about pastoring. And the message that I have is a teaching message. And as I was reading this information about you, and I'm not worried about your calling as far as your character as being a Christian, because I read Sister Rochester, she accepted Christ at a young age. She's a Christian. Sister Gillis, it said that she was a faithful servant. Sister Deidra Baldwin said that she involved herself in many things in the community and also in the church. And Sister Pearson, she said that she gave her life to Christ and she joined this church. So I'm not going to talk about your relationship with God, but I just want to share some information to you about your character. You know, you accepted, you know, Jesus Christ into your life. Now you have been appointed, and this is the title of my subject, appointed to serve. You have been appointed. People have looked at your life, they have been watching you, and now you are here to serve in the army of the Lord. Colossians 3, 23, 24 says, whatever you do, work hard. As for the Lord and not for who? Men. Knowing that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance as your reward. You are serving the Lord, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Don't forget that. It's all about Jesus. And that's who we are serving. The standard for deacon and deaconess has been set high, and we should not take it lightly. As she had read in 1 Timothy, the 3rd chapter, 8 through 13. Deaconess deserve our highest respect because they represent the Lord Jesus Christ in our midst. They deserve our highest respect because they represent our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We should always pray for our leaders and help them. Don't talk about them. Don't criticize them, but pray for them and help them. We should also help them to fulfill the great responsibility that has been given to them. The concept of women serving as deaconess appears very early in the church. The deaconess were often connected with the widows. Whole role was prayer and act of godly service. They also ministered directly to other women in evangelism and teaching, and preparation for the baptism and general discipleship. These were some of the work that the women did back when, in the Old Testament, they served other women, they taught them. And this is what you're going to be doing. You're going to reach out to young people and teach them as to how they're supposed to live. 1 Timothy 3:11 says, in verse 13, it says, in the same way, the women are to be worthy of respect, not malicious, talkers, but temperate and trustworthy in everything. Qualification of a deaconess is to be worthy of respect, not malicious, but temperate and trustworthy. Let's look at these qualifications. Women worthy of respect. And these women are serious. They're dignified. They're not clowns. Have you ever seen some people who act just like a clown? They always think everything is funny. They're never serious about anything. But you as deaconess, you are serious. You are dignified and you're not a performer or frivolous. You're concerned about the work of God and you're concerned about other people. And then he said, not malicious talkers, motivated by or resulting from a desire to cause harm or pain to another. This is not what you do. You are to love people. You are to care for them. Don't do things to try to ridicule them or cause harm upon them. Apostle Paul said, do not gossip or spread rumor. You should be able to keep a secret tone and confidence. And there are going to be many things that are going to be discussed in your meeting that you are not to tell anybody. And there was a situation, you know, where my husband had pastored, you know, and the deacon, you know, with me. And you're going to have some enemies. You're going to have somebody that's not going to like you or going to think hard of you because of your calling, because of what you're doing. And then in this particular situation, before the members could get the message was already out among the congregation. What you do amongst the deacons and your pastor is to stay there. You should be a woman of God that can keep secret, that should be able to trust you. You are not to be a chatterbox, always running off with the mouth of nothing important. Choose not to speak evil of others. And then the Bible said that you ought to be temperate. You ought to have a mild spirit. The Bible said that you ought to be sober. That means you are serious about the calling that you have on your life and that you have self-control, not emotionally unstable, not swayed by sudden impulse, you know, that you so easily to get upset, you so easily to bite back when something is said that you don't like, but you ought to be calm and wait and hear from God. God would give you something to say. He would give you the time that you need to say it. So you should have a calm spirit. Amen. Reliable in a person that has good judgment and that you are sensitive to others.
Yes, yes.
Avoid embarrassing or upsetting others. You are temperate. You have a mild spirit. And lastly, the Bible said that you ought to be trustworthy in everything. Faithful in all your relationship. Someone who keeps her word, not to be flighty. A person that is irresponsible. These are the qualifications that Timothy has said, that Paul has said unto Timothy about a deaconess. That you ought to be worthy of respect. You are not to be a malicious talker, but temperate, having a calm spirit, and you ought to be trustworthy. Women were used during Bible time to help in the growth of the ministry. So let us explore God's word and see how these women used their gift of servanthood to glorify God. I'd like to talk about Phoebe. In Romans 16:1-12, it says that she was a God-fearing woman in the days of Paul. Paul sent her to Rome, to the congregation there. God said in his word, Romans 16:12, he said, I commend unto you Phoebe, our sister, which is a servant of the church, which is at Central, that you receive her in the Lord as becometh saints, and that you assist her in whatever business she has need of. For she has been a sucker, which means she has been there when the time got tough. Isn't it good to have somebody on your team when things are tough?
Yes.
That they can handle the problem? Amen. Amen. You need that person on your team. That when the time gets tough, they're standing there bold and tall to help you in trouble. And this is what Paul said about Phoebe. He said, for she has been a sucker, not only for the congregation, but also she was there for him. The Apostle Paul called her a sister. When we look at the word sister, you know, in our churches, this is how we greet each other. Sister so-and-so, or brother so-and-so. So when we call each other sister, that's somebody that is very dear to me. That's my Christian. That's my church person that I can say sister. And Paul called Phoebe sister. He called her sister because of the love and labor she shown among her sisters and brothers in Christ. And this is what you're going to do. And this is what they're going to call you, sister, because of your love and your concern for your congregation. He said that she was a servant of the church. She was a dedicated member, teaching other women, taking care of the needs of the poor among the congregation. Phoebe was like a trainer, and you know a trainer, when they are training an athlete, they are there for that person, and they are there to make sure that that person has everything that he or she needs. Whatever it is, whatever that person needs, they're right there, and this is what you're going to do. You are going to be a trainer. You're going to be there for your pastor. You're going to be there for your member. You're going to look among your members to see if there's anything that they need, because you are there to help them. Amen. And this is the kind of person that Phoebe was. She would always have a look on the congregation. She could dot every I, she could cross all the T's, anything that needed to be done, she was right there. And then she seen that somebody was in trouble, she knew about it. She was there to assist them. And this is what you're going to be as deaconess. You're going to have an eye for the people of God, that you're going to see and take care of their needs. Phoebe was a woman that loved working for God's people. And Paul sent her to Roma to help and say, look, honor this woman. She's a great woman of God. Let her do the work that she is called to do. Amen?
Amen.
And then God uses women that are willing to serve. Are you willing to serve? Are you really willing to get down and say, and get dirty? To get your hands dirty? To go in rough places that nobody else would go, because you know there's somebody over there that needs you? And that's how I was studying my lesson. It made me think about a young lady. You know that we have the noonday prayer. We go from house to house. And I had called this lady and asked her if she wanted to have prayer in her home. But she said, you know, I want prayer in my home. But she was bedridden. And she wasn't where she could, you know, take a bath. You know, like she had to wait for somebody to give her a bath. But she said, because I'm ashamed to let, you know, other people come to my home, especially the men, because of my nature, because of what I'm going through. But this is where deaconess are needed. You have to go into homes, you know, where people are sick. You know, and they don't want the men there because they're ashamed of their condition. But you are a woman, and she is a woman, and you are to go there and help her. You are a willing servant. Lydia,
amen,
was a willing servant. After following the Holy Spirit leading into Macedonia, Paul made his first evangelistic contact with a small group of women. And it reads, on the Sabbath day, he went outside the city gate to the river, where he expected to find a place of prayer. We sat down and began to speak to the women who gathered there. One of those listening was a woman from the city of Thyatira, named Lydia, a dealer of purple and cloth. She was a businesswoman. Purple cloth was valuable and expensive. It was often worn as a sign of nobility and royalty. So she was producing something that was very expensive. And I knew that she loved her job, and she did a lot in serving these, selling this cloth. But she was a worshiper of God. The Bible said that she was a worshiper of God. And we have a lot of worshipers of God that come to our churches. And they're just religious people. For some, it's a tradition, because this is just what you do. But the Bible said the Lord opened her heart to respond to Paul's message. How many of you know that God has a plan for his people? Amen. That there are many people who are waiting to accept Jesus Christ into their life. And Lydia, she was a churchgoer, but she didn't have Christ in her life. But God sent Paul. He sent her there because he knew the heart of Lydia. And because of the preaching of God's word, she accepted Christ into her life. And when she and the members of her household were baptized, she invited us to her home. If you consider me a believer, she said, in the Lord, she said, come and stay at my house. And she persuaded us. She was hospitable. Not only did she accept Jesus Christ into her life, but she said, come on into my home. You know, we have to want more of Jesus. We want more of him. All that I can do for you, Lord, this is what I want to do. Because I want to be a servant. I want to be a willing servant. I don't know about you today. And I was telling, you know, my Sunday school class, don't ask me to do something. Because I go out my way. It's not about me. It's all about Jesus Christ. And what you are doing today is about serving the Lord. I'm willing to do whatever I can do for him. Amen.
Amen.
You have to be willing. willing to serve God. As Lydia's faith and love was a blessing to the congregation at Philippi and a great encouragement for Paul and his companion, so also your service, prompt by faith and love for Jesus Christ, will be a blessing to many. It will be a blessing to many. And you would never know who you bless. You would never know who path you have crossed because of you being willing to serve our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. God used women that are willing to praise Him. Amen. Are you willing to give God some praise? When we think of His goodness and all that He has done, surely our soul cries out, hallelujah. We give Him the highest praise. And this woman that I want to talk about is Miriam. And I love this story about Miriam because Miriam was the sister of Moses and Aaron. And if you know the story, they was about to cross the Red Sea. And say Pharaoh was in behind them, and they were standing there praying and waiting for the sea to depart. God told Moses to stretch forth the rod. And you know the story. They went across on dry land. And when God calls you to accomplish all that you're trying to do for Him, we ought to give Him some praise. As pastors were praying for those that God had healed their body, God has saved their soul. That's enough for us to give Him some praise. So Miriam had a spirit of praise. There's going to be many things that you're going to have to face while you're on this journey. But when God and many things the deacon faced that the church don't even know about it. But when you come together and discuss these things, these problems that you're having, and you go in prayer, and God work these things out, and when the pastor's over there preaching, oh, I'll see you praising the Lord because of what the Lord has done. And this is what Miriam done. She praised God. She said, let's sing to the Lord. Let's give praises unto the Lord because it was Him that brought us across that Red Sea. Him because He's good to us. When God brings us out, we ought to give Him praise. There's many things, and I can't stress this enough. There's many things that you're going to face. The devil comes to steal, kill, and to destroy, and he don't want a growing church. He don't want a spirit-filled church, and he uses people to try to turn down the kingdom of God. But through prayer and through praise to our Almighty God, say, I'm going to turn your kingdom down. I don't care what you do, but I'm going to sing praises unto the Lord. God has given Miriam a heart of praise. And finally, Abigail, she was a courageous and wise woman. Let me tell you the story about Abigail. The Bible tells us that there was a certain man that had some property. He was wealthy. The Bible said he had 1,000 goats and 3,000 sheep. It was a time for them to shear the sheep, cutting away of the wood. And then while the sheep was in the pasture, David, which was a kind man, an humble man, he decided and took it upon himself to help Nabal as his servant was shearing the sheep. Then after, you know, David had done all this work and his men had worked hard, didn't have to do it, but he did it. He wanted to show kindness towards Nabal, but the Bible also said that Nabal was a mean-spirited man. He was a rich man, but he was very selfish. He only thought of himself. But David didn't care. He didn't care. He wanted to do something to help Nabal. And then when they had finished the work, David told his servant to go to Nabal and tell him, you know, what we have done. And because we have done this, you know, pay them for what they've done. Give them whatever they need because of the work that we did for you. We did it out of kindness. But Nabal, mean old man, this is what he said unto David. Who is this? David? Who is this son of Jesse? Many servants are breaking away from their master these days. Why should I take my bread and my water and my meat? I have slaughtered for the shearers and give it to men coming from who knows where. You're going to meet people like that. You're going to meet mean spirit people. You know, you do all you can for them. You go into their homes. You visit them when they were sick. And then you ask them to come to the church, or you might ask for a donation, or help me in this problem. And they say, why should I help you? You hypocrite. You know, ain't none of you saved. You know, and this is what happened to David. David got the report back. And David was furious. He was upset. He was mad because of what neighbor said. Look what I've done for you. And you want to talk to me this way. And because of that, David told his men, come on, get come together. We're going to battle. We're going to fight neighbor because of what he has said about me. But there's times in our lives, you know, when we are confronted with situations, we don't think. And this is why it's important that we be temperate, that we have that mild spirit, that we would take that time just to go away and steal away into our secret closet. Do not take matters into your own hand. And this is what David was going to do. But thank God for Abigail. Amen. Thank God for Abigail. When Abigail heard the news, the servant went to her and said, look, this is what David's going to do because of your husband and because of his mean spirit. David is coming to destroy our people because of that. Abigail acted quickly. She took 200 loaves of bread, 2 skins of wine, 5 dressed sheep, 5 seat of roasted game, 100 cakes of raisin, 200 cakes of pressed figs, and loaded them on the donkey. Then she told her servant, go ahead and I'll follow you. But this thing she said, don't tell my husband. And I want to leave a quote with you today. You can't tell everything that you know. There's something you just got to keep to yourself. And I want you to get the point. Because I'm not talking about husband and wife matter. I'm talking about church business. And the reason why she wouldn't tell her husband, because he was mean-spirited. He had no intention of helping David. What do you think would have happened if she had said to David, to neighbor, that I'm going to do this anyway? He would have stopped her. And then they would have been destroyed. But it's good to be courageous. It's good to have wisdom. You know, God blesses us and we should be able to share what God has given us. And this is how Abigail felt. Abigail used wisdom in speaking to David. And then this is what happened. When Abigail reached David, she did it out of faith. And she did it because she wasn't afraid. And she confronted David. And I imagine her saying to David, David, I know that my husband did you wrong. And I know that it wasn't right the way that he was treated you. But this is what I have. This is what I'm going to give you. But the good thing I like what she said to David is that think about what you're doing. Your reputation is on the line. If you do this thing, you will regret it for the rest of your life. David listened to Abigail and changed his mind of thought. I would like to encourage you to let Abigail be a model for you in your life. And you being courageous and using the wisdom that God has given you. In your future life and calling, you will sometimes meet with difficult situations that require courage. Allow yourself to be guided by the word of God. Let your most important aim always be. Let your most important aim always be the spiritual welfare, the salvation of the souls of people with whom you have to deal with. God wants to use women of integrity. He wants to use women who are not afraid to stand up for what is right. But in all of your standing, he said what? Get understanding. God loves you. Your people love you. If they didn't love you, they would not have appointed you to serve as deaconess. It is a serious calling. And as I had the young lady to read 1 Timothy 3:1-13, yes, in the beginning of it, talking So you are appointed to serve. You are appointed to get down and get dirty. As the song says, I give it all to you, Lord. I give my life to you, Lord. I give it all to you. And this is what I want to say to you as deaconess. Do it all to the glory of God.
Amen.
It's not about me. It's not about you.
Amen.
But you're working for the Lord. And when there's times in your life that you feel like you can't go on, go anyway, because God will give you the strength to do what you have to do. They are dependent on you to do the work of the Lord. Amen. Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise his holy name. As I said, you know, I just want to talk to you and tell you, because I take this serious. I take the calling that God has placed on my life. I take the appointment that God has given me. I take it serious because it's all about him. You are representing our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So let your character display that. To be like Jesus. Oh, how I want to be like him. I love him and I want to be just like him. And then he will say, well done.
Amen.
Thou good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a few things, but come on up now and get your reward. You'll be like one of the ladies who called Jesus, brought me over. I can say hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's been hard, but I made it. I made it. I made it. I made it. And I want him to tell me, well done. Thou good and faithful servant. I want to say, be encouraged. Be encouraged. Work hard in your church. Work hard for your pastor. Stand by his side. Watch him. See whatever he needs. Be right there to assist in everything that you can. Love your pastor. Love the congregation. And God will bless you. Amen.